everybody. Thanks for your attention, please. Thank you very much indeed. Welcome to this meeting of the Cabinet. This is a key milestone in the municipal year. Budget Cabinet. It's traditionally a time that's a lot of work putting, to get to this point. So without further ado, I'll go straight into the agenda. Okay. Number one on the agenda is Members' Code of Conduct, Declarations of Interest. Can I ask the many members who have a declaration of interest? Councillor Leech.
Thank you, Chair. There's a mention of Mariners Park within the papers, and my husband is actually an employee of Mariners Park.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? No? Thank you. Okay, number two is the minutes. Minutes of the last meeting we've recently published. Is it agreed that I sign the minutes of the last meeting?
It's agreed.
Okay, three on the agenda is leaders updates, executive key decisions taken under delegated powers. Period date, 8th of January 2020. To date, there were no such decisions taken in that period. Number four is quarter three, 2019-2020. Revenue financial monitoring pages 1 to 14 in your hard copy. Councillor Janette.
Thanks for that, Pat. So this is an update, it's quarter three update on our revenue financial monitoring report. This is the third year that I've been responsible for setting a legal budget as the politician involved. It's probably the hardest year, I have to say. We have been subject to savage and unfair cuts from this government, who I noticed recently have, in what we all now started to call the unfair funding review, again targeted at councils such as Wirral, whereas the Leafy Shires down the south, southwest seem to have come off much better than us. However, we have got to set a legal budget, and our residents expect financial competency from us, and that is what they are doing. We forecast an overspend at this point of 2.7 million, and that absolutely corresponds with the pressures upon this council, particularly in social care, which I know my colleague Chris will be speaking about later on. The increased demand for our services for vulnerable children and adults is in the main due to austerity, which is pushing people through our doors. The lack of investment to date in the NHS has meant that the burden has fallen on local authorities. It's also diminishing our capacity at times to deal with that demand, but we are absolutely doing our level best. We're experiencing currently £30 million of demand pressures, but with careful management of activity and funding, we've mitigated that to £5.8 million. Also this year, a number of saving initiatives have not materialised, such as the change of operating model for the Forum Pavilion and Golf, and they've contributed to the overspend. In order to mitigate this position, we've made use of the flexible use of the capital receipts initiative. This is where we can use the monies gained from selling unwanted land and buildings to support revenue expenditure. It's just a little change within the organisation. However, this is not a sustainable way of supporting the organisation, and we can't rely upon that in future years. An overspend is not a viable position. A number of savings initiatives are underway to reduce the overspend. This includes a spend freeze, a recruitment freeze, and a series of dedicated actions addressing each area of overspend. If we cannot reduce this overspend, it will impact our ability to set a balanced budget in 2020-21 and may require us to draw on our already depleted reserves. And I have to say that that is not a position any local authority wishes to find itself in, but it's not an uncommon position either. We're not alone. other local authorities are experiencing similar problems. We only have to look across the water to see what Liverpool City Council are going through for one. However, it is our collective responsibility to set and manage a balanced budget. Members and officers are working together to address this issue, and I want to put on record my thanks now to all the officers involved and all my colleagues sitting around this table today that all work together to deal with a balanced budget. I will not allow us to go the way of the Tory-led authority in Northamptonshire, which went bankrupt last year because of mismanagement of their finances and an over-reliance on their reserves. So we will avoid that. Has been painful, and it's not a situation I want to find ourselves in going forward. So I'd like to thank everyone who's worked alongside with me.
Thank you, Matt. Thanks for that. Councillor Liz Leech.
Thanks, Janette, and thanks to you for all the hard work that you've done on this as well. It hasn't been an easy task for you. You know, when the National Audit Office confirms that real-term cuts in spending power is 35.1% and 52.8% reduction in government economy. So we need to do a hard task.
Any other members? Councillor Selby Jones.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, thanks, Janette. I know you've worked your socks off to get us to the situation we're in now, but I think it's beholden on us collectively to mention the fact that this financial position is reflective of most local authorities, particularly in the north of England, and it's as a direct result of sustained 10 years of austerity. And I think that's the fact of the matter. It's all very well devolving responsibility from central government to local government. If you don't give us the associated prerequisite funding to pick up those responsibilities, the situation can even be worse. And I personally would like to thank you for the work that you've done. Okay, Councillor Jim McManus.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate what everybody else is saying, Jeanette. This seems to be the really, really tough ask to balance the budget this year. And I want to thank you for that. And some of our delivery services have, quite rightly, as you said, given us added pressures, but we're absolutely convinced in this cabinet that keeping off in-house the full use of our quarters is the right thing to do. But because of that, we have to look at that very clever ways of balancing that budget. And I mean, if you look at the investment that we spent in delivery services, we're still spending more than £300 million a year, which, given the situation we're in, is pretty amazing. So, thank you.
Okay, any other members? Can I just say a few words? I mean, obviously, the budget sets out how the council meets its obligations, and thanks to you, Janette, for all that work, and to the officers to get us to this point. You know, and we are ensuring as a party, that's where we've come from, is that the most vulnerable are not left behind, and everyone receives, of course, the services they expect. It's a budget that has no major service cuts, no compulsory redundancies, and is reducing council tax for the poorest in our borough. And I think I'm right in saying, certainly to my knowledge, the only one in the LCR region is actually doing that. So we've got to be congratulated for that, but we are the poorest in our society. It's a budget also that's backing up our green credentials, following our emergency climate motion that we passed unanimously with this council last summer, with a range of environmental initiatives such as energy efficient buildings, by investing from the capital programme to ensure the energy efficiency of the council buildings, which is very important indeed. We're also driving forward green construction of UNOS by recommending it to the Wirral Road Company Board in the construction of the Birkenhead Commercial District. And we see that also within new developments at Wirral Waters, which are going up as we speak. Investments in active travel, of course, in tandem with our climate emergency declaration, an opportunity to be more assertive in achieving decisive shift away from car travel towards greener alternatives. Investing in forest schools, an initiative to help children from disadvantaged backgrounds to develop skills and confidence to help them achieve in a school environment. The courses which will last for 10 weeks with their families, the confidence to build friendships and take part in outdoor activities together. And biodiversity wildlife corridors, Council has planned a formal programme for 2020-2021, leaving many verges unmown. RHS improved wildflowers to encourage and nourish endangered pollinating insects, hoverflies, moths and bees. So we're doing a lot in terms of our green credentials. We're doing a lot in terms of building on what we said we would from last year by passing our climate and agency motion on that declaration. That's all credit to Janette, that's in this budget. However, despite this, we are reaching, or we're not, breaking points, bigger cuts on the way next year, which means we will be at the stage, which means we might have to consider wider services that the people rely upon. That's the facts of the matter. And as I said, we have worked hard under enormous pressure to keep our library and services and children's centres open, because the effect things like chances of people in work. But these new cuts next year would mean putting services, as I say, at risk. Just finally, but just mention as well, we are moving, are we not, into a new committee system in the next municipal year, with responsibility, decision making, and hard choices shared in a proportionate system across all the parties and on this council. And I would ask all parties here in this town hall would appeal to them to appeal and help us lobby this Conservative government to stop before it's too late. It's simply the Conservative Party to put aside tribal loyalties, rise above party political bickering, and join with all those other parties to get the best possible deal for the world. Because, you know, after all, that's what residents want to see, and that's what we keep saying at every meeting we have in the council chamber. It's important if the other parties in this chamber are saying that we agree on most of the issues and most of the things that people want to see, that the residents we represent want to see. It's golden on them to put aside, as I say, those party loyalties and work with us to lobby central government to stop these devastating cuts that are going to be with us for the next number of years. Okay, are there any other comments from members? No? I second it. Can we agree?
Agree.
Okay. Number 5 on the agenda, quarter 3, 2019-20, capital model, pages 15 to 34.
This is an update on our capital programme. So, capital spend, like revenue spend here, is a reflection of our values as a council. Capital programme shows how Rural Council is investing in the long-term future for the whole borough, for residents and for businesses. This report shows the changes to programmes, the most significant change being the rephasing of capital investment projects in regeneration. This is because as opportunities arise, we're aligning our funding to best access these schemes. This includes rural waters, housing infrastructure and property purchases. We've also secured some new funding which is supporting capital programmes such as the alcohol treatment and for the transport feasibility studies. So I recommend approval of additional funding. There's a list of schemes there in that. I'd just like to highlight a few. I'm sure some of my colleagues might wish to say a few words. Our tree challenge, lighting and covert surveillance equipment, New Ferry Community Centre, which is a fantastic, really pleased to give funding to that. And the People's Pool, so they are just some on that list of amazing investments that this council is making. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Williamson. Any other comments? Councillor Jones?
Yes, thanks, Chair. You mentioned the People's Pool. That's someone who's a ward councillor for New Brighton, who was proud and privileged to have the biggest outdoor pool in Europe located within my ward. I'm particularly delighted that we found some money to support the feasibility study of the people's pool. So once again, in my hands.
Okay, any other comments? Councillor Liz Grey.
Thank you. I just want to say thanks and celebrate the fact that despite the cruel cuts from this government, we've still managed to invest heavily in tree planting, and that we've already started fulfilling our pledge to more than double our tree planting by 2030. I'm really pleased about that for the current climate. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments? So, do we have a proposal? And I'll second it. Can you agree?
Agree.
Thank you very much. Okay. Number six on the agenda, 2020-2021 budget proposals. Screen proposals, page 35 to 40 on the hard copy. This went through all the scrutiny committees in this last month. I think it's, as I said here, it's important to make sure members of all parties have the chance to properly scrutinise the council's budget, and we propose to save money, of course, as I said earlier, is vital in the present environment. And of course, the scrutiny committee brings the experience and knowledge and expertise of all members into the process. They're all generally helpful debates and constructive feedback. The cabinet, of course, places on record and stands to every member who participated in this process. At the request of the members, the budget scrutiny process was revised in this municipal year, you will recall, with budget proposals for 2020-21 reviewed as part of the four overview scrutiny committees in January. The process replaced the closed workshop sessions utilised in previous years. Information presented to each committee, together with copies of these, of course, can be accessed using the links set out in Appendix 1. Are there any comments? Yeah. Councillor Williamson.
Thanks, Mike. I'd just like to thank all the members that attended those scrutiny workshops. It's far easier and much lazier to sit on the sidelines as an opposition member and just hurl rocks at the administration when it comes to budget decisions. So it's nice that most opposition members have actually rolled up the sleeves and come along and taken part in the process. So I'd like to put on record my thanks to those that did that in a constructive way.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councillor Anita, Leech.
Thanks, once again. Thank you that the scrutiny committees have really helped and assisted Cabinet in their decision making, aligning ourselves with the priorities of the Wirral plan and looking at technology and digitalisation improvements. Thanks to all.
Anybody else? No? Okay. We agree. I'd like to first of all propose the recommendation that the Cabinet request the Civil Comm Centre will deliver the scrutiny reports as part of its deliberations in developing a budget recommended for the Council. I'll propose and I'll second it.
Thank
you very much. Okay, item number 7, Revenue Budget 2020-21 and Medium Term Financial Plan 2021-2022, 2024-2025, pages 41-64 on the hard copy. Councillor Williamson.
Thanks, Pat. This report provides an update of the budget 2020-21 and the medium-term financial plan previously reported to Cabinet on the 23rd of December 2019. And I'd just like to say for me that a budget is a statement of values, and this budget is our values as a Labour Council. And I'm very proud of what we've done and what we will achieve despite the situation we found ourselves in with prolonged and aggressive austerity. This sets out the background and key elements contributing to the preparation of the budget for 2020-21 and sets out recommendations on the budget and council tax for the council. The council continues to face financial constraints and pressures. The medium-term financial planning period to 2024-25 is expected to contain further grant funding reductions and increasing financial pressures. This report sets out how the council will balance the budget for 2020-21 and updates the medium-term financial plan for the period 2024-25, highlighting the risk of a significant shortfall in future years of close to £30 million. The Cabinet has to recommend a 2020-21 budget proposal to the Council on 2nd of March 2020. This includes a recommendation on the Rural Council element of the Council tax to be applicable from 1st of April 2020. This is in order to formally set the revenue budget and Council tax for 2020-21 financial year. For Rural Council services, Council tax has increased by 3.99%. That is 2% adult care precept and 1.99% increase in council tax. This is in line with virtually every other council in this country. We can't say what the fire and the precept will be yet, so we're unable to say that. I feel very strongly that this government has continued to devolve the responsibility for local services to local council taxpayers, and it's unacceptable. The growing demand and the growing pressures in social services, whether that be children or adults, are presenting us with an almost impossible situation. Our current adult social care pressures are £13 million. The increase in the adult social care precept will bring us around 2.8 million, Chris, you can probably write it, 2.85 million, which, as we can see, doesn't go to scratch the service. However, what I am pleased to announce is that I have put nearly £900,000 in our budget to give 9,000 of the poorest households on the rural a reduction in their council tax. And that will go some way to mitigate the council tax increase. As far as I'm aware, we're the only council certainly across the Liverpool City region to have done this. This shows that we are actually prioritising vulnerable residents here on the rural. And those residents won't have to apply to us for that reduction. It will be automatic when their council tax bills are calculated. We have to agree a budget and set this budget on the 2nd of March. And I am hopeful that after all this hard work, and after all the pressures that this council has come under consistently since 2010, that the other parties in this council will see that we've done our level best here to protect our residents from the worst ravages of austerity and supporters on this. And once again, I'd like to thank all of my colleagues here around this table who have played their part, and all the officers within this council, not just in the finance team, all those in particular in the finance team, but in every other department that have got stuck in and helped us to deliver a balanced budget, which in times of sustained austerity is becoming increasingly difficult. So thank you.
Thank you, Pat. I think all the way through this morning, we've been talking a lot about the increasing demand in social care. And Janette's right, you know, it's a complete lack of proper government funding for people who really need care packages. The demand in Wirral, as we know, people are living longer, which is really good news, but a lot of those people are in decades sometimes of ill health. And it's time that this government did a proper review of social care. And I think the other thing that we're a little bit worried about is the certainty around the public health grant. Out of the public health grant is all the contracts for things like drug and alcohol, long-term contracts, that if we don't get the money on a continuing basis, those contracts may have to be disbanded, which is a real concern because we are trying our hardest to look after the most vulnerable people on the Wirral. But I'm afraid this government is doing absolutely nothing to help us.
Thanks, Councillor Jones.
This month, May, I've been on the council 10 years, and every single one of those 10 years, you know, we've had to, no deal, we've got cuts to funding from central government, and as time has gone on, it's got harder and harder and harder, and to me, I can't see how much worse it can get, though I have no doubt looking at the record of the government that it will get worse. Local Conservatives, not once in those 10 years, have condemned the cost of funding of local services in Wirral. Not once have they stood up for the people of Wirral to lobby their governments to try and secure the better funding. And in fact, judging by recent press statements from the Conservative Group of Wirral Council, it seems clear to me that they don't believe that any council should get any funding based on deprivation, and that council should be funded on business rates income and also council tax income, which is great if the council tax base and the business tax base is sufficiently large enough to fund the local services. Boris Johnson will be next in December as well, promising to level up. But judging by the leaks of the Fair Funders Forum tender for the bus, and it's clear also that the politicians aren't even in charge down this semester. The events of the past few days, which has led up to the resignation of the Chancellor, actually proves that the country is currently being run by various special advisors and so-called spats. Led by an individual that even David Cameron described as being a career psychopath, who recently advertised for more advisors, inviting various weirdos to come up around our country. I fear that we're heading for dark times, and sooner than we get rid of this, the better.
To highlight the extraordinary pressure that the local authorities under. Obviously within my service area, we've seen a real balloon in terms of demand. In 2010 we had 550 plus children in care, and now we're responsible for 850 plus. There has to be a cause as to why 300 more children come into care 10 years on than previously. It can't happen without causation, and we really have to look at the fact that it's coincided with 10 years of local government cuts. These things are not a coincidence, they can't be. £230 million since 2010. So there's a staggering human cost to what the central government has done to local authorities. And I find it impossible to find any validity in the claim that it's financial irresponsibility from one particular council, because nationally, there's a couple of years ago, 2018, there was a record number of children in care. So this is not a local anomaly.
tell Stuart about psychopaths. I'd say you'd have to be sociopathic at best to sit in government and administer the cuts that this government have administered to councils like ours, at very best. I completely agree. And it's not good enough for opposition councillors to run to the press with snide remarks about us not managing our finances well without any recognition or acknowledgement about the part that their governments have played in trying to bring councils like ours to our knees. But we're not on our knees. We are coping. But if this is not sustainable, we cannot do this every year. Unless you hope that Boris Johnson put his money where his mouth is now he's in government and pays back the North in a way that is meaningful to us as well.
So the report sets out the 2020-21 schools budget and changes to the schools funding formula funded by the ring-fenced dedicated schools grant. These were supported by the schools forum at their meetings on the 6th of November 2019 and 5th of January 2020. So we have engaged with local schools on the changes to the funding formula and this year's school's budget. With what I might describe as some reluctance, because I wanted to take this opportunity to talk a little bit about the current situation in schools funding. So there's a new national formula that's being imposed by central government, and despite promises from this new government of investment in public services, there's only been an insultingly small increase in funding that doesn't cover the losses, not anywhere near the losses that schools have suffered in the past 10 years. So the government announcements would equate to an extra 8 pence. People come, and I quite frankly think that's insulting to local people. I'd just like to read out a quote from a piece in the Times Education Supplement, which was published in June 2018. I wish I could do something to give my pupils the message that someone out there values them as highly as I do. Instead, I have to pinch every penny and make do with things I know which would be so much better. There are simply no more savings to be made, yet funding continues to lag behind inflation. And when the national funding formula kicks in 2020, we're on our own. There needs to be more investment in our schools, or standards will suffer. Students are working harder now than they ever have done. Certainly they are more focused than I was when I was their age. But the strain takes its toll, and the social pressures they face are immense. The same is true for my staff. They work tirelessly to make sure their lessons are challenging and engaging, their marking is effective, and they willingly give up their time to support the wider life of the school. I wish that I had better resources to support them, but I don't. This isn't the statement of a politician, it's the statement of one of our local head teachers, Adrian Whiteley, of Mosland School, which is my former school, and he's also the head of the school's forum here on Wirral. This was written coming up to 2 years ago, and it's a story of local schools doing their part and working with the hand they've been dealt, and the government not taking seriously the education of our children and grandchildren. I asked Mr. Whiteley for a further comment on this year's budget, and he stated, "Many schools and academies will see this year's increase as an opportunity to prevent themselves from falling into significant deficit. In fact, a number of schools will still have deficit budgets and balances. For years, we have seen budgets frozen and cut, while inflation has been between 1 and 2.5%, and we are now almost 10% worse off per pupil than we were in 2009. So reluctantly, we have to accept the 8 pence extra for people. However, I wouldn't dare to imply that the pressure educators feel every day is down to the schools not managing their budgets properly. When I went to school and fell behind with my reading and writing, I received extra support, both at home and from the school, and became the first person in my immediate family to go to university. If I had gone to school with the funding situation facing schools today, I have no doubt that I would have struggled to catch up, and I would be paying for the price that someone put on my education for the rest of my life. So I would urge anyone who values the transformative power of education to call on local Conservatives and the government to take the education of this generation seriously. I propose the school's budget to, and I propose that we accept the recommendations to report.
Thanks, Councillor Usher. Can I thank you also for that illuminating narrative? And it's even more illuminating when it comes from somebody who I know as well. I'm a local head teacher. That's the reality on the ground. You would be saying that. That's somebody who experiences that day in, day out. So thank you for that. Councillor Williamson.
Thanks, Tom. What you've just said is absolutely in keeping with the general narrative that's gone out this morning around consistent underfunding and how that is absolutely eating away at the fabric of this borough. However, we are determined to not let that happen. I think this absolutely destroys the myth that we live in a meritocracy, where if you work hard enough and you work hard enough at school, you will just triumph regardless. That is not the case. This, we are seeing our brightest pupils who just happen to be born on the wrong side of the borough being held back by this government. And actually bringing us back to our earlier point, for me, this just perpetrates a system, I'm afraid, that rewards and promotes privileged sociopaths. And that's what we're seeing. And those very people are making decisions about young people that's going to affect them for the rest of their lives. I just want to put on record again my thanks to everyone involved in education. As a former lecturer myself, it is the very heart and soul of what we do for young people, and it breaks my heart to see how young people and how our educators are being treated by this government.
That's Councillor Williamson. Any other comments? Councillor Seacombe?
Thanks, budget cabinet last year, I was at the website schoolcuts.org.uk. And I would urge any parents out there to go and look up the school that your children attend and to see how cruel they've been affected by government cuts for their education. I said last year, and the same is still true today, if we don't invest in our young people, then we're not investing in the future of the country. So the impact of school cuts cumulatively on Wirral, because the school cuts website, there's 2020 is a £7.8 million shortfall, and that works out to £132 per pupil. So it's every single child at Wirral that's been shortchanged by its company, £132, and that's an absolute disgrace.
Councillor Jones.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. You used the word some reluctance, Tom, and you'd say it was an insult. I couldn't actually state publicly what my thoughts are on it, because I'd probably be marched out of the room. But 8p extra spending per pupil, 8 pence, that wouldn't even cover the reintroduction of a third of a pint of milk that pupils used to get, which was taken off of us by a previous Tory administration. So I just think that it's more of an insult, but being mindful of the language, I'll stick with the words that you've used and say it to them. Thank you.
Okay, any more comments? I have a proposal for the recommendation.
Just to wrap up, I appreciate the comments around the table, and I need to hammer home that this is not about any particular group of young people, and it's not just about vulnerable young people and people who are struggling educationally. It's throughout every single one of the young people's Wirral who are in school today. You know, a large number of our most able pupils go to the 6 lowest funded schools. So this affects the future of every single person in education at the moment. I'm going to propose the report, Chair. I'll second it.
Can we agree?
Thank you. Okay. 7.3 on the agenda, capital programme and financing 2020-2024, Councillor Williamson.
Again. Thanks, Chair. This report provides Cabinet with the draft capital programme 2020-2025 consideration and referrals to Council for approval. It also includes information regarding the revenue implications of this programme and an update on the latest forecast for capital receipts. The 2020-25 council programme represents a combination of schemes originally approved as part of the 2019-22 programme, updated through the capital monitoring reports in 2019-2020, and new bids and inclusion as detailed in this report. The proposed programme would mean the council embarking on the following schemes of work: just over £103 million for 2021, £16.1 million for 21-22, £3.4 million 22-23, £5.7 million 23-24, and £2.5 million 24-25. As the programme stands, this will require up to £17 million on supported borrowing from 2021 to 24-25. It includes within the proposals of new bids, includes health and safety schemes, green schemes, namely energy efficiency of buildings, £1 million, and new cycle infrastructure, £1 million. And really, these that are absolutely taken on board.
Activities underpinned by SIPFA's 2017 Code of Practice on Treasury Management, in which there is a requirement for Council to approve an annual capital strategy. This report fulfills the authority's legal obligation under the Local Government Act 2003 to have regard for this code. The intention is to give a high-level overview of how capital expenditure, capital financing and Treasury Management activity contribute to the provision of local public services, along with an overview of how associated risk is managed and the implications for future financial sustainability. Decisions made this year on capital and treasury management will have financial consequences for the authority for many years into the future. They are therefore subject to both national regulatory and local policy framework, as summarised in this report. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor. Is there any more comments? Are you going to propose?
Thanks.
I second. Do you agree?
7.5, Treasury Management Strategy Statement 2020-2023.
Thank you, Pat. Treasury Management is concerned with the effective improvement